Greetings and welcome back to room 303 AP English, the Roberts Lectures. We are in the poetry section, and we turn now to George Herbert's The Pulley on page 766, this offering from 1633. Now, Herbert is an important writer for us in the metaphysical tradition, as we will qualify it. Of course, we know a lot about this from our study of John Donne. We'll see other titles of Herbert, The Collar on page 986, The Colossian 3:3, Our Life is Hid on page 938, Easter Wings on 939, and Virtue on page 950. He is a Welsh-born poet, dates 1593 to 1633. He was the priest of the Church of England as well as an important voice in that metaphysical tradition of poetry. And we know so much about this from our study of John Donne. You can just go back and look at our lecture at learnstrong.net on valediction for a bedding morning to get a sense of that one. Now, the poem is called The Pulley, and we want to pay attention as we get ready to read this together to this notion of the conceit or the extended metaphor, as is often the case with metaphysical poets. And what exactly is it that Herbert is suggesting about the human condition? I would definitely write that down as we read and study the poem, we'll try and answer it. When God had first made man, having a glass of blessings standing by, let us, said he, pour on him all we can. Let the world's riches, which dispersed lie, contract into a span. So strength first made a way, then beauty flowed, then wisdom, honor, pleasure. When almost all was out, God made a stay, perceiving that alone of all his treasure, rest in the bottom lay. For if I should, said he, bestow this jewel also on my creature, he would adore my gifts instead of me, and rest in nature, not the god of nature. So both should losers be. Yet let him keep the rest, and keep them with repining restlessness. Let him be rich and weary, that at least if goodness lead him not, yet weariness may toss him to my breast. Now, we were, of course, just referencing Thomas Hardy's channel firing, and of course there we saw the voice of God. Here we see the voice of God. And this notion of rest is going to be for us an important idea throughout that poem. By the way, just to Hardy's on 765, I'll do a 3A observation really quickly. Notice that God was saying, if indeed I ever do blow the final trumpet, for you are men and rest eternal sorely need. Humans need rest. Now, of course, this is a poem that's going to build heavily on all kinds of religious allusions, A-L-L-U-S-I-O-N-S. Remember our lectures on Milton's Paradise Lost. Remember when we looked at the Genesis 3 account of the eating of the forbidden fruit. Of course, in Milton, it's an apple. Not in the 1611 King James Version translation of that story, but in Milton, it is an apple. You'll remember that the curse that falls on Adam is that he will have to till the ground, and he will forever have to till the ground with the sweat of his brow. This seems to suggest there will be no rest, and yet notice, of course, that the Sabbath day is a day of rest. Of course, the other allusion is a Greek one. You have to know your Pandora story, don't you? And of course, those two stories of Eve and Adam and the forbidden fruit and the Pandora story are in many ways the cosmogonic stories, the origination stories for the questions of pain and suffering in the world. That is to say, the question of theodicy. Go back to our studies of Milton in Paradise Lost to play that game as well. Why do bad things happen? Why is it that humans have no rest? Well, this is going to be an interesting poem in that regards. And of course, the title, The Pulley, is going to have a lot to do with this. That is to say, to pull something or to draw something to something else. Let's just exegete down the poem. When God at first made man, having a glass of blessings standing by, we could have called it, of course, the chest, if we're talking Pandora. Let us, he said, pour on all we can. Notice the us is that proverbial us of the Genesis 1, 2, and 3 stories as we outlined it in our study of Milton. He says, let the world's riches, which despised lie, contract into a span. That is to say, within the control of human beings. In other words, humans are going to have control. So notice the things that are bestowed on humans. Strength, beauty, wisdom, honor, pleasure. We immediately think, of course, of our cardinal virtues of Plato's Republic, and of course the St. Augustinian virtues that will follow as well to comprise those seven, right, of wisdom and courage and temperance and justice, as well as of faith, hope, and love. Notice here, pleasure is the one that ends. When almost all was out, God made a stay, that is to say, stopped, and perceiving that alone, it's a key word, of all his treasure rest in the bottom lay. Now notice that rest here can mean repose, it can mean security, it can also mean all that remains, right? For if I should provide rest, that is to say, contentment, we might say, bestow this jewel also on my creature, he would adore my gifts instead of me. Now, of course, Herbert, because he knows his biblical allusions and references, is making a reference to the idea of Romans at the very beginning in that New Testament book, where the idea is that humans will worship the creation instead of the creator. And here the same notion is echoed. He says, if I give him rest, then he's going to adore nature, because he'll rest in nature, and not the God of nature. So both should losers be. In other words, I will have missed my purpose. Final stanza. Yet let him keep the rest. That is to say, notice the rest of the things I've given, but not rest. But keep them with repining restlessness. That is to say, we're always going to be that species that's constantly needing something else. We bore so quickly, yes? And because we bore so quickly, we're always looking for the next thing. There never seems to be a way for us to be content for very long. What is it Sidney says? Thou blind man's mark, thou fool, self-chosen snare, fond fancy scum, and dregs of scattered thought. And then later in that sonnet, desire, desire, I have too dearly bought with price of mangled mind, thy worthless ware. Herbert, of course, enjoying making a reference, obviously, to that Sidney offering. He says, if goodness... let him be rich and weary. In other words, you're gonna have all this stuff, but you're always going to be tired. We think of Milton's Samson Agonistes here as well. That at least, if goodness lead him not, yet weariness may toss him, notice the pulley, bring him to my breast. In other words, what is it that brings us ultimately to a need in faith and the like, Herbert says? It is the fact that we never can finally get peace. We never can finally get rest. And sooner or later, it seems, the human condition is to ask, is this all? Is this all? I mean, there's got to be something else. The questions, of course, of greatest value, metaphysical questions, always seem to play that game. Well, it, 2a, obviously, human's curiosity is a blessing as well as a curse, is a major message here. The symbolism of the pulley and the way in which not having rest, not having contentment, always being plagued with desire is what drives us to constantly keep seeking for more, is a fundamental notion as well. And it does lead us, of course, to 3a. Think about how this, again, poem will play off of all of those classic allusions, Pandora, of course, Plato's cave allegory. Remember what we said in Book 7 of Republic in our lectures, you can go back and take a look at that, that for us to get out of the cave, we had to be dragged, kicking and screaming. We don't want to go. And of course, there's always fear and pity involved, fear and pain involved in always that escape from the cave of darkness of opinion and belief. Of course, T.S. Eliot's East Coker comes to mind. The only wisdom we can hope to acquire is the wisdom of humility. Humility is endless. And that's really what Herbert is driving at. In other words, after you've gained all knowledge, you're still longing for something else. After you've gained all experiences, there's still a longing for something else. It is that longing that, of course, the theologian will point out, as St. Augustine often did. It is that longing to lead one back to some kind of metaphysical searching. This is where Herbert is headed. I want to give you as well Daniel Bornstein. We've mentioned this historian many times in 303, and of course his classic, The Discoverers, where he tells history from the perspective of the human species is constantly wanting to gain more knowledge and understand more of the world. Finally, at 3b, what do you think about humans and their capacity for contentment? Is that a good thing or a bad thing, that we always seem to be striving for more? Or how about this one? When was the last time you were content? You felt at peace. And when was the last time that you weren't? And that discontentment led you to something, right? To go maybe in search of something. Well, a brilliant little poem. Notice Herbert, right? Very small but brilliant in terms of the length of the poem. Thank you.